Hello anatomy friends, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will be discussing the muscle compartments of the hand. And there are going to be five muscle compartments in the hand, and this area is unique in the fact that there is a fairly high frequency of both extrinsic as well as intrinsic hand muscles. And we will discuss the difference between what extrinsic and intrinsic means. So as I'm fairly sure you understand, the hand is the most distal portion of the upper limb, but it's also the most dexterous. You can do a lot of small but quite complex movements in this area. Additionally, we have touched on this in a few areas throughout this session, but the digits are numbered for ease of discussion. They're going to be numbered 1 through 5 from lateral to medial. So I always remember, you always have to think of the hand in anatomical position. So the thumb is going to be numbered 1, then we go 2, 3, 4, and then the little finger is 5. And so this would be lateral, and this would be medial in anatomical position. Most intrinsic muscles of the hand are innervated by the ulnar nerve and its branches. Recall, the ulnar nerve is the one that travels all the way from the axilla without doing too much. It hits a few muscles in the anterior forearm, but the hand is really its place to shine. But 3.5 muscles are innervated by the median nerve. So most notably, the thenar compartment of the hand. If you hear thenar, think thumb. So these three muscles are all innervated by the median nerve, and it also innervates 2 of the 4 lumbrical muscles in the central compartment, the lateral 2. Before we move to the compartments, I want to take a moment to discuss the difference between extrinsic and intrinsic muscles in general, and then specifically regarding the hand. An extrinsic muscle is a muscle that has a proximal attachment and muscle belly not located in the region it most greatly affects. So, for example, the forearm has many, many extrinsic muscles of the hand, as their proximal attachments and muscle bellies are not located within the hand. They're going to be in the forearm, but their long tendons, and even up past the elbow for those proximal attachments, but their long tendons are very much located in the hand, and their distal attachments are going all the way towards, to say, the phalanges. So you can see, particularly in this case, the flexor digitorum profundus tendons are playing a big role in terms of the hand. So they very much play a role in terms of the actions of the hand. And it's not just in this palmar portion. Recall that there are all those extensor tendons on the posterior portion. This differs from the intrinsic hand muscles, sometimes referred to as short muscles. Intrinsic muscles have both their proximal as well as their distal attachments within the unit it is affecting. And so when we're talking about the hand, the proximal and distal attachments are both located within the hand and will, of course, affect the actions. So very prominent, where am I? Yeah, here we go. I'm in the right place. So when we're discussing the muscle compartments of the hand, the most action, or the most, I would say, bulk in terms of musculature is on the anterior or palmar side. The posterior side of the hand is almost all tendons from the forearm and the extensor expansions formed by the extensor digitorum tendons primarily. The basic setup of the palmar portion of the hand are two eminences and kind of a depression between. The larger one is the more lateral one and associated with the first digit and is referred to as the thenar eminence. The hypothenar eminence is laterally located, so, and it's smaller and associated with the fifth digit. So think first digit here, fifth digit located if you continue up this way. And in the middle is a central concavity, like a little valley between these two mountains here. And the most superficial thing in this area, other than of course skin and superficial fascia and maybe a few veins, is a portion of very thick, deep fascia referred to as the palmar aponeurosis. This will cover As mentioned, this is deep fascia. It's a thickened set of deep fascia, and it will cover the deeper soft tissues and tendons. So an added layer of protection in an area that greatly interacts with the environment, so it needs a bit more protection. If you look down at your own palm, I'm sure you can notice a fairly prominent thenar eminence under your thumb, a smaller eminence under your little finger, and a slight concavity between the two. Okay, let's get into the basics of these compartments, starting with the big one, the thenar compartment, which is located right at the base of the thumb. There are going to be three intrinsic hand muscles and one extrinsic tendon, which is the flexor pollicis longus, and we will see all of these in lab. These muscles will only affect the first digit, and it's going to allow abduction. Where are you? Abduction. As well as flexion, and the fun one, opposition. You can't see the opponents here in this image, but you can see it on this illustration. Opposition is something you hear as being unique to primates, and it's a complex movement, meaning it involves movements from more than one joint, so both the carpometacarpal and the metacarpophalangeal. So it begins with the thumb in an extended position, and then it moves it to an abducted position with the CMC joint, and then the thumb is flexed by the MP joint. As mentioned earlier, it is this compartment that is the major exception to the rule of intrinsic hand muscles being innervated by the ulnar nerve. This compartment is innervated by a small branch of the median nerve that does branch either within or distal to the carpal tunnel, so can be affected by carpal tunnel syndrome. And this is the recurrent branch of the median nerve. And you can see it kind of, this itty bitty thing right here is going to innervate this compartment. There is a matching but smaller compartment on the opposite medial side called the hypothenar compartment, and they are so matching that the names of the intrinsic muscles are almost exactly the same as what we had with the thenar, but replaces pollicis with digiti minimi, meaning smallest digit. So the actions taking place in this compartment are the same as well. So you're going to have abduction, you'll have flexion, and you will have opposition. And this compartment is innervated, as you would expect most intrinsic muscles, by ulnar nerve branches. The adductor compartment is relatively simple, as there's only one muscle, and the compartment name tells you exactly what it does. It adducts, specifically it adducts the first digit. So it's this large muscle right here, and it's a little bit deeper. You can see a little bit of it popping out superficially, but the majority or the bulk of it's going to be deep. The adductor compartment, that relatively simple one, is going to contrast with the central compartment, which is comparatively complex. And this is the compartment that really has all of those flexor long tendons from the forearm. So the flexor digitorum superficialis and the flexor digitorum profundus. Remember that flexor digitorum profundus is traveling all the way to the distal phalanges. So these are quite prominent in this region. You can see them here. These are just the profundus. The superficialis have been removed. You can see them here as well. Also in this compartment are these funny little worm-like muscles that are unique in the fact that their proximal attachments are not on bone, but instead on a tendon. And specifically, it's these flexor digitorum profundus tendons, and these are the lumbricals. These cross those metacarpophalangeal joints of the digits 2 through 5 and will play a role in terms of flexion of those. But then they will insert or have a distal attachment on those extensor expansions on the posterior side of the hand. So they'll actually extend the PIP and DIP joints, or more generally the IP joints of 2 through 5. So that the fact that it has that attachment on the extensor expansions is the reason why you have a very big difference between the types of actions that occur here. These muscles are uniquely innervated. The medial two lumbricals are innervated by ulnar nerve branches, as you would expect most intrinsic hand muscles to be, but the lateral two, these two right here, are going to be innervated by the median nerve. They're a little bit closer to that thenar region, so it makes sense there. Lastly and deepest, there is the interosseous compartment, and these literally span the distance in some areas between the bones, specifically those metacarpals. And there are two types. There are going to be the dorsal interossei, of which there are four. And these are really the only intrinsic muscles that are sometimes considered part of the posterior hand. And there are three palmar interossei muscles. These are all innervated by the ulnar nerve, and these will enact similar actions to those we discussed for the lumbricals. So flexion of the MP joints and extension of the interphalangeal joints of digits 2 through 5, because these also insert on those extensor expansions. Additionally, these muscles play a role in abduction or adduction of the digits. Recall, when discussing the digits of the hand, abduction is going to be away from the third digit, and adduction is towards. So think moving away from the third digit or moving towards the third digit. That's why this illustration looks like it's kind of flipping us off, because that is the all-important third digit by which abduction and adduction occur. So the dorsal interossei are going to be the ones that abduct, and the palmar interossei will adduct. I remember this mnemonic by DAB. So dorsal, DAB. And pad. So palmar, ad. So dab and pad help you remember which one does what. And the good thing is that it's the same for the interossei of the foot as well. So one mnemonic for both. All right, excellent. We have reached the summary slide, and we did go over quite a bit. So congratulations. I would suggest starting with the generalizations for this area, and then adding in the big picture details from the compartments next. Thank you for your time and attention, and have a great rest of your day.